Canna Care Docs, compassionate, compliant, confidential.
Welcome.
Hello.
Can I hear myself? Can you hit my headphones up a little hotter for me? Guest over there? Nope. Next one over.
Further.
Next one.
Unnamed.
There
guest.
You go. Yeah. Perfect. Right there.
Good. All right.
We're the Young Jerks. My name's Mike Crawford.
And I'm Brianna Morrell.
And we're here every Saturday. We're very excited this week after the election results.
Yes, at least here in Massachusetts.
Well, I'm excited about a Donald Trump presidency as well at this point.
Yeah, I mean, I think
it's gonna give us a lot of good content.
A lot of fodder.
Yeah. We don't even deal with national usually, but
I'm pretty thankful.
Think we might have to actually. But yeah, I mean, we're very excited about we had a couple wins actually.
A few big wins.
And we have two campaigns in, two winning campaigns. It's a celebration today, right?
It's a big celebration day. I think everybody in Massachusetts.
Did we say our names? You're Brianna Morrell. And I'm
Mike.
Okay. See, I'm all over the place today because I just saw another guest come in. And we're actually going to have him over there. We're directing guests. We're going to have you sit over there. We're going to fix that mic for you. Yeah, we have several campaigns here. Two. Let's be precise, right?
Yes.
I'm excited. Are you excited today?
I am very excited. It's much more relaxed than last week, I think, when we were tense and
We were tense, weren't we?
We were definitely tense. I think we were predicting that it would win, but we were still a little bit
nervous. I was wrong about something, too, the prediction. I was off by like 5 points,
yes.
At least. 5 to 10, depending on how you measure it. But I was very optimistic, and it was a little closer than we thought. But we still won big. We're talking about yes on 4, obviously. But we're also talking about our state rep that that I endorsed and the show endorsed early on. And I actually took some heat over that later on. But he won. I mean, I don't think I should have gotten any heat over endorsing him. But in some quarters we did. We just basically, the big thing is that we had a big win for state rep and Cambridge and Somerville. And we're very happy to bring him on the show today. What do we call him now? Do you know what I know the name? Do you want me to say it or you want to say it?
You can say it, Mike.
Do you know what it is?
I believe so.
He's got a title now. It's officially I believe. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe we need to find out, right? I get things wrong, right?
Make sure that we're not saying things.
Mass State Rep Elect Mike Connolly.
Oh, thank you.
Welcome to the show. No
great,
money, Mike, as someone said. Someone in Somerville said today. I kept saying to people, we saw each other at the binge party, the Boston Institute of Nonprofit Journalism, Chris Ferrone's party, and we were waiting in line together. And I was like thinking old school. Like I was like, oh, you got to meet this guy, telling people. People already knew who you were. They
I know.
Right?
It's been amazing.
They know who you are now?
People around the community. Yeah, I've been involved day in, day out for a number of years now.
So. Did you expect to win by 800 votes? 800, how many was it?
We won by close to 400 votes.
It was 400? I thought it was 800.
It was 8%.
That's why I get the number.
It's about 54% to 46%.
It's a pretty close race.
Yeah, it was very tight.
But you still
race.
Won by 400. I mean, that's a good.
Yeah, very, very tight, very competitive, but solid victory. You know, there were, I believe there were 59 incumbents challenged in the primary when we won the big race, and only two of the challengers won. So it was huge honor to be among the few who.
I imagine the other one was probably an incumbent that was in trouble too. I don't know who it was, but I just guessing because.
Yeah, the other challenger was Juana Mateus. Not sure who the incumbent was. She defeated, but another young. Person,
because it wasn't like Toomey really did anything wrong. Like you know, sometimes people go down because of scandal or corruption or something.
That's a remarkable thing. I mean, you know, Representative Toomey's popular, well liked.
He is.
His life. He's been committed to the community. So it was. I understand why when we started the race, you know, many people were not at all sure that we could pull it off. But it was really a tribute to. Hundreds and hundreds of volunteers who we organized, and ultimately the voters who made the decision on election day.
I think they made the right decision too, especially the issue that I, you know, was so focused on, and you helped us with. You know, number one, the medical marijuana. there was a hearing. You know, I've talked to Rep Toomey over the years and City Councilor Toomey as a resident of Cambridge and, you know, one of the most vocal advocates on marijuana issues in the city. But, you know, it was a very telling sign when the dispensary that was, you know, in its final vote to get, you know, to, we're going to open something in Cambridge if the City Council voted on this specific evening. And Rep Toomey had issue, you know, had work at the State House, and he was back and forth, but he did show up at the City Council, and he couldn't stick around the extra 5 minutes to vote on it, number one, which I found kind of discouraging. And the big thing, you know, he spoke on another issue, but didn't choose to speak on the issue where most of the audience was there for that issue, and he's right. And he's running for re-election, and there you were. You had signed in early. You were running for election against him. Everybody in the City Council knows who you are. You ran for City Council. You almost made it last time. And you were the first one to speak for the medical dispensary. And you spoke very strongly, and it worked. It was reported right away in the newspaper. You helped us on that campaign. And I think it became a big issue when the legal campaign came out, and Toomey's totally against legal, talking about opioids. And you want to talk about opioids because you know it reduces it. So I just want to give you a huge round of applause for what you did for us.
Oh, thank you.
And the whole station to WEMF Radio.
Yeah, and I actually helped organize and kick off a big canvas in Harvard Square last weekend for the SN4 campaign. And we sent folks out to talk to voters and get the vote out in our community.
And so you're going to continue to be an advocate, obviously, for our side, for the legalization in the medical patients?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, you know, certainly there will be, I'm sure, future questions to be
I think answered. There'll be a lot of future questions, especially both on medical and on the recreational side. And, you know, the fact that you took time to make time for the medical patients and that Tim Toomey didn't, how can somebody not make time out of their schedule to go and speak for medical patients? It should be your job as a representative to represent the patients in your area.
And how long does it take? 30 seconds.
It doesn't
take 30 seconds to just say, I support this, even if I got to go and I can't vote
and
on it.
Really, it's maybe like you have to sit through 15 or 20 minutes of, you know, pre-hearing, like whatever they're presenting. And then if you're there and you sign up right away, you just speak. Yep.
Right.
You leave, you're done.
Yeah, but a City Council can speak at any time during those meetings when they pop in. He had, you know, he as a City Councilor, State Rep, he was always going back and forth between the meetings. So when he pops in, they allowed him to speak on anything he wanted to. I also want to make sure that we got another huge guest here, too. And I'm not sure I know how to say it. I'm going to screw up the last name. I screwed it up earlier.
We were both debating.
I think I can say it. I think I'll give it a shot again.
It's not an easy one. I'll let you try.
He was, and the title, too. You were, for the SM4 campaign, you were one of the main political directors, right?
Yes. Yeah, I was technically Director of Communications.
Yes, Director of Communications. Jim Bogusani?
That is exactly right.
Hey, I got it right the second time.
Congratulations.
I usually get most of the names wrong.
You're clapping for yourself over there, Mike.
Good job, Mike Crawford. Finally got one right. I got a few right lately.
Yeah, you've been doing pretty well.
Yeah.
Like my name, though. That's the one that...
Bree?
Well, wait.
So, huge... Forget about the names. Huge congratulations, Jim, because we won. I mean, this is amazing. We've been waiting for this for so long. It was a hard campaign. I mean,
It was a tough campaign. It was a very, very tough campaign. We knew we had the right message, even though our message sort of migrated a little bit with focus groups, but that happens in campaigns. You know, you test your messages, you find out that maybe the message that you had is good, but it may not be the best. But we found out through focus groups and through talking with people that we had to revise our messaging a little bit. And we did, and it struck a chord. So, you know, we couldn't be more happy with the voters of Massachusetts that they went our way. It was, it's just a great thing to see the terrible mistake of prohibition finally ended Massachusetts. So,
yeah, really.
Yeah. And, you know, thanks to people like the representative elect who did help in Harvard Square and helped, you know, just with adding a voice to this. And by the way, a voice up on Beacon Hill now with the implementation of this, an extra voice like yours is a great thing for us.
Absolutely.
Because already we're starting to see some
pushback, right?
Some pushback.
That's what I want to tell you. You're right on where I want to go next, Jim.
Yeah,
you and I mean, are always on the same page,
yeah, I
man.
Mean, that's really what we have to start talking about.
Because tell us about that. Because, I mean, we're already, like, I'm starting to put together my story on it, and it's immediately, you know, talking about defending the home grow, defending the potency, right, defending the driving. What's going to happen? What do you think is going to happen? Do you think there are actually Jason Lewis and these guys are actually going to try to force something through the State House?
Yes, I do. I think there's going to be some pretty quick legislative action. I also think that there's going to be resistance to that legislative action. The first thing that I'm not hearing, unfortunately, is recognition that we passed
a great law. I think.
I think it's a great law.
I do too. This is where I'm going to go off, because you know, we can't change any initiatives. Like, we couldn't change the medical marijuana law for 6 years, so we couldn't change it this round. And we can't change this legal law if we wanted to as citizens for 6 years. I think we should ask the legislature for the same type of you can't touch it until something we know is broken.
Right.
Until.
Well, how about this?
Give it a shot.
How about the legislators don't start altering this until the regulators have had a chance to actually do their jobs?
Right.
Now, the recognition should be that we passed, and I mean the voters of Massachusetts passed a regulated system, not a legislated system. The legislature had their chance. So look, we set up a regulated system just like the state regulates alcohol. Part of that regulated system, we have written right into our initiative, is creating the Cannabis Control Commission, which writes the regulations that will govern the industry. Now, what disturbs me is that I haven't heard of Jason Lewis or President Rosenberg or Speaker DeLeo say, we recognize that regulators are going to be running this, just like we run banking in Massachusetts or construction or the cosmetics industry. There's all sorts of regulated bodies. They work well. You know, legislators don't usually step in and say, this is what we want to do. They say, we give regulators the authority in real time because they can move quickly, which the legislature can't. They weren't designed to move quickly. Right. So what I'm going to be advocating, and what I hope a lot of other people do, is say, let's give regulators a chance to actually write the laws or write the rules, write the codes. It comes down to codes that will govern the system. And then if the legislature feels that they have to step in, do it then. Not before regulators are even appointed, much less a chance to do their jobs.
It's unbelievable. And the taxation thing too really bugs me, that they're talking about, you know, I think hopefully Charlie Baker has a pledge, no new taxes. If he breaks it on this, I'm going to go crazy, because they should not raise that tax. That amount that you guys did it for a good reason, kept it lower than Colorado, because we want to eliminate the black market. And yes, it will actually lead to more tax revenues, I'm convinced. The casino and the slots taxes are so high in Massachusetts that they're under revenues because they raise the tax too high, and people are still going to Connecticut because they got better, better offers, better payouts. It's just better down there because the operators aren't giving so much away to the state in terms of taxes, like they do in Massachusetts. We do that so often. They talk about, we're talking about energy costs. We want to reduce, our global footprint, a green footprint, whatever we call that, right? Mike can tell me in a second, but the energy footprint, right? Yeah. And we're sending people up to New Hampshire to buy cigarettes. I mean, this is the new black market, is because of the tax. And they want to do the same thing with cannabis now? No way. I'm totally, if they try to raise that tax before, we've at least had a year or two to see how much revenue comes
in. Exactly. Remember one thing. The Cannabis Control Commission, under the way we wrote the initiative, the Cannabis Control Commission each year is mandated to make a tax recommendation to the legislature each year. Now, these are people who are going to be looking at the industry, analyzing sales, analyzing revenue, analyzing future sales. They're going to have projections. And they can say to the legislature, with an informed opinion and, you know, data, to say, this is what we think we should do. You know, to have the legislature do it right out of the block because of some vague belief that they should do it, not based on data, is the wrong way to go. And it's not what the voters passed. So, you know, I think everybody, Mike, you have been so good during this whole thing. We've worked together on various things. You know, you've written good stories, and you've, I think, rightly criticized the media for letting a lot of things go on the other side. You know, that was infuriating. And you've been at this a lot longer than I have. And I've told a lot of people who have been in this movement for a long time, I don't know how you've kept your sanity for so long. And your faith in fellow man, when you see the nonsense that some people keep, you know, promoting the reefer madness stuff. And I'm thinking, I just got into this, you know, I'm a sort of communications professional. I got into this, you know, just 18 months ago, and I'm thinking, I can't believe what I'm hearing, you know, and I feel bad that I'm late to this cause, but now that I'm in the cause, I couldn't be more thrilled that we're on the right path here in Massachusetts.
Me too. I think we are. I'm so excited. After we won, I was just like, oh my God, I can't believe it finally happened.
It's such a big win, but I think the other thing, too, that a lot of people are concerned about are losing home grows. I know that was a lot of questions with the way that the law was written, too.
Yes.
A lot of people were even confused about what is their actual plant limit, what are they allowed for clones, mothers, whatnot. And I think that that's something that can easily be picked apart by legislators who do not understand the needs for home grows either.
I'm hopeful that that won't be touched because it wasn't touched in other states after passage. Mm-hmm. You know, what we have to point out is that Colorado has the same home grow limit we do, 6 per person, 12 per household. I think Oregon, one of them has none. Washington may have none. Oregon may have 6. I think, again, once the hysteria passes, once they find out that not all law-abiding citizens now, because they have the ability to home grow legally, are suddenly going to become criminals, they're going to say, maybe we shouldn't have been so, you know, hysterical about this. So I'm hoping that there's a measured approach to everything in our initiative, but particularly home grow. Because home grow, I think the people who are going to do home grow, it's going to be a micro market.
Yeah.
You know?
Or just for themselves.
Or just for themselves.
Yeah.
You know, it may be just
or maybe a friend, you know, that has MS or cancer.
That's, I mean, that's fine. But it's not going to be anything that affects retail sales.
No. No.
You
not
know?
At all.
So,
and if it does, those are the people. I mean, in Colorado, it showed that the major busts that they go after are the people who are doing it without a license in a warehouse with like 500 to 1,000, the gangs. And
who
that's
should
what
have
they
a license to cultivate.
Yeah. And that's who they focus on is the true bad guys, the guys who are cutting corners.
As well they should.
Where they you know, the average person just growing their little 6 to 12 plants that they don't mess with. Mike Connolly is over here. He's been listening to all this. State rep elect from Cambridge and Somerville. I mean, I'm so happy today you're here and you won. I just like beaming, man. I can't believe we won an election. Laura Pispis is here too.
Hey, guys.
You're happy about this?
I'm happy. You know, I know we lost the big, you know, Trump one and everything, but man, for us as the Young Jerks, like we won.
Yeah, we won because we got our guy won.
Yep.
He's been a regular guest on the show
he's
a guest co-host and friend. And
absolutely.
So, what do you think about all this at the State House? You're going to be new up there. Have you talked to some of these reps about some of these issues that we're talking about the initiative yet? Have you, where are you on that at that point?
Have you measured the temperature?
Yeah.
I'm still, you know, I've definitely learned, you know, in the work I've done in City of Cambridge politics that it's good to touch base with other members, engage a sense of like what they're thinking. So certainly I think that's important to do, but, you know, I know from, you know, when I went through law school and just our understanding of democracy, when, you know, voters go to the polls and render a decision, I mean, that deserves, you know, the utmost respect. And, you know, we have to honor what voters voted on. And so I think that, you know, that would be my, you know, my sort of starting point and really where I'm going to stick true to is what the text of the ballot initiative says, you know, so... Honestly, with the election of Donald, I was hoping
every single rep would say that right now.
Right.
Every elected official of the State House would say that.
Right.
This is why we applaud you all the time.
I know. And I have to admit, you know, I mean, with the election of Donald Trump, it's sort of consumed a lot of my thinking since the ballot question passed. And so I'm certainly looking forward to thinking more. You know, one issue, the only question I've heard from constituents since Election Day on this issue, and maybe Jim, you have some insight into this as well, the concern that minority applicants might be shut out.
Mm-hmm.
And I know, I think we were chatting a little bit earlier.
Yeah,
about
Jim, you want to talk about that? Because that is in the initiative.
In the initiative, yeah. And that's something that we're very concerned about because we didn't want to see the community that has been most, you know, disproportionately impacted by prohibition now be disproportionately impacted with the legal industry. So we wrote in the initiative that the Cannabis Control Commission has to come up with a provision or something that will encourage minority or, you know, Latino, Black, any community that has been adversely impacted by prohibition, right in there, that they have not only encouragement, but incentive to get into the new industry. That's the first, ours was the first initiative to have that clause in it. We're very proud of it. California put that clause in theirs. They wrote their initiative after us. I'm glad you brought that up, because that's so important. You know, it's a new industry. Also, we put in there that anybody who has been arrested for possession of marijuana, or even a felony charge.
Like Steve D'Angelo, who couldn't come into Massachusetts because he had a felony for selling weed.
Right.
I mean, it's just
so if it's marijuana, that does not shut you out from the legal industry. If you have another felony,
if you're a child abuser,
correct? If it's just marijuana, then you still have the ability to enter the industry.
What about other drug-related charges?
It's only marijuana. Okay. Yeah, it's only marijuana. So if you got caught somehow, you know, trafficking, you know, cocaine or another drug, that wouldn't work. But yes, marijuana, we had to write that in, and we did, because we felt it very important. It's the same community that was adversely impacted, and we considered people who had been arrested for possession or even more serious charge, as long as it's marijuana, were people that should be allowed in the industry.
Yeah, and
absolutely.
Yeah, and at the State House, what do you think will happen up there, Mike? I know you haven't probably talked to as many of them, and you haven't been up there for a year or two, but what do you think is going to happen? Do you think these guys are really going to push this through? Push up higher taxes right away and mess it up?
Yeah, it would be hard to speculate. I mean, I'm due to be sworn in January 4th, and you're all invited. It's open to the public, so I'll spread the word about that ahead of time. It would be hard to speculate. I mean, I've heard that, I don't know, it might even be possible that they might start looking at things prior to then.
I know, before you even get sworn in, right?
So,
is that possible? They could do that, right?
Could they really jump on it?
There's a possibility. Procedurally, I think it's much more difficult to get something done.
I don't know if the governor will sign it. I'm hoping the governor's on our side on this, especially the tax.
You know, I think it ought to be acknowledged that it seemed like the political establishment of the state to a large degree
was against
lined
it.
Up against this, and voters nevertheless said, we have faith in this concept. We have faith in this language.
In this campaign.
We have faith in this campaign, despite the strong,
and they and they rejected a lot of lies from that opposition campaign that the media didn't call out. And it's so funny because I was watching these forums a lot of times. I'm watching, you know, the questions from the audience, the way the audience reacts to things. And it became very apparent to me at a lot of these forums like UMass Boston, that our audience was more educated on what was going on and who was lying and who was telling the truth than the moderators from WGBH and some of these big wig stations.
Oh yeah.
I mean, it's that's
or
the
senator who headed up the special committee on marijuana.
Right.
When he said,
Thank you.
The, I think it was the Massachusetts Public Health Association, the first forum where he and I went at it. He said that you could get 5,000 joints from an ounce.
Right.
And
whose ounce is that?
And the audience started yelling at him, and he repeated it one more time, and the audience started yelling again. And then, you know, it dawned on me, having read that report and having seen when a committee is formed and the chairman of the committee had opposed
decrim medical
and had opposed medical. And then supposedly has an open mind.
On legal, yeah.
About legal. That sounds like somebody who says, you know, I'm against a 20-mile-an-hour speed limit. That's way too fast. And a 30-mile-an-hour speed limit. That's way too fast. But I'm open-minded about an 80-mile-an-hour speed limit. You know, it just didn't
it doesn't make sense. Yeah.
So what I would like to see, Senator Lewis, we were on opposite sides on this issue. I think a lot of it was kind of, frankly, it was a lot of reefer madness stuff.
It's like reefer madness 3.0.
Yeah,
it's
exactly.
Like this new geek style of reefer madness.
You know?
It's all about the edibles.
But I would like to see him say, look, not only was I against the prior two initiatives, but I was the chief surrogate for this one. So I'm going to step back on this. I'm not going to be the person that leads the charge on Beacon Hill, because my credibility is probably not quite right for the person who can have an open-minded approach to this. I hope he does that, but we'll see.
Yeah, we will see. It'll be very interesting.
I think it's going to be up to the people, too, to be putting pressure on
that's
the legislators
right.
and to stay on top of this going forward.
Like and call
if they
them.
Can have the same kind of you know, outcry like they have against Trump, against, you know, the legislators. Right. Don't let them raise the tax.
Don't let them, don't let them get rid of home grows. You know, this is, you got to tell them, don't mess with the initiative. The initiative passed on legalization. Don't touch it.
Right.
Right.
Let the commission. Home grows and the tax. Charlie Baker's in a very, very peculiar spot because if he, as you, I think you pointed out earlier, he's taking the no tax. You know,
and this would be a tax increase. Yes. It certainly would. No tax increase.
This is a tax increase.
Yeah.
You know, so he's got to be in a box. So it'll be interesting to see what he does. But anyway, I really hope that they don't, they leave a lot of things alone. You know, funny, we met with Michael Capomano, who's a great guy. And he said he made it clear he's going to vote for this, and he made that public. So he was a yes vote, along with Seth Moulton, Elizabeth Warren. You know, we did have, didn't have nearly as many supporters as the other.
But we had a lot of the bigger federal offices.
We had a lot. We did. And we were very pleased. Jim McGovern. So, you know, that was very helpful to us. They were out front. And Capuano said, you know, I'm going to vote for it. But I remember when we passed Proposition 2.5, Capuano was a state rep back then. And he said the legislature did visit that. They did rewrite it. And he said, but we didn't change the intent. We just made it work. We pointed out that this is slightly different. This is a regulated system. It's different. We don't think there has to be a major rewrite.
Yeah, what's the rewrite that's needed?
There isn't any. There is none. Yeah. If they want to visit drugged driving, if they want to come up with some sort of, you know,
limit, see if it's a problem first. I don't see that it is a problem.
You know, but you know, maybe they can visit that. They should have visited when they, you know, whined about it in 2008 and 2012. The problem is, it's a very complicated thing to take on. You know, and by the way, police right now have the ability to pull over anybody who's driving impaired.
Exactly. Yeah, that's right.
All you need is probable cause.
That's right.
You know, and our opponents sort of like, oh, it's going to be terrible. We're not going to be able to control the roads. Well, they said the same thing in 2008 and 2012, and there has never been an increase in drug.
It's so funny because they say we can't tell if they're impaired. I always say that's probably because they're not impaired.
Right, exactly. That's not an impaired.
If you fail the field sobriety test, you get pulled off the road. Mm. It was a huge red herring.
Yeah, it's insanity.
I saw our favorite person, John Carmichael, Walpole police chief, this week on Fox 25.
Oh, I did too. That truly angered me the day after we won.
Right after winning, they brought him on.
I was more angry at Fox 25 than him, though. He was actually kind of okay that day. He was kind of like,
he was mellow, but
yeah, I don't think the state house will do anything about it.
But even he had said when asked about the driving and driving under the influence, he was like, well, you know, right now we just give them the same field sobriety test and it doesn't work because it doesn't necessarily match up. So he was kind of hinting maybe we need some kind of specific marijuana test.
Right.
No, it's not an impairment.
It's not an impairment. If you can't walk, then you get pulled off the road. You know, if you can, then you're not impaired.
If you're driving in some kind of way that's crazy or dangerous to others, even if you're not intoxicated, maybe you're just under duress and you're driving crazy, you get pulled over.
You get pulled over. Right. And if you fail the field sobriety test, it doesn't matter what substance you're either intoxicated on or you're not. If you can't do the many things that they ask you to do, you get pulled off the road.
Yeah.
So, again, I think it's going to be something that is going to be... is going to receive much less attention after passage, just like it did in 08 and 012. Nothing is going to happen, if you ask me.
Yeah, I only remember hearing about field sobriety issues and driving on marijuana issues really just before the election.
Right.
And it's been, we've had, you know, legal or decriminalized marijuana, medical marijuana for like how many years? Like 8 years. And they really only started bringing that up, I feel like, the past year or so.
The campaign.
So it's just as a campaign, as a tactic, not even as an actual problem.
And they never said we've seen an increase since
2008.
They have
not.
Yeah,
they
have no
didn't
data.
Say it because they couldn't say it. Because they haven't seen it.
Yeah, they have no data to back them.
None.
617-500-7100 is the phone number with the Young Jerks here every Saturday at 6 p.m. My co-host over there is Brianna, or Bree. Did I say it right?
Yes, you did.
I did.
You got it.
Sometimes I go Brianna. Or
Brianna.
Brianna. Yeah, Brianna.
Brianna.
Oh, see, I can't do that.
Now it's all bad.
Bree.
Just Bree.
Bree. And my name's Mike, obviously, Crawford, Big Mouth. We have Mike Connolly here, Big No Money Mike. Mike, you're going to something tonight. You got to leave soon. Where are you going? What's going on?
It's the Laughing Liberally. It's a comedy show.
And you're going to be performing at this thing?
Not performing. I'm just going to be a guest. So I don't know.
This is what you have to do now as a state rep. You have to go out and be the guest of
local comedy shows.
Local comedy right, shows. Right. Yeah, this is part of my plans for world domination.
And I said
through comedy shows.
I gotta apologize because I said, "Hey, Mike," because like I'm used to, because I've known you for a while now.
Oh yeah.
I gotta say, "Hey, state rep."
Yeah,
I mean, you know, call it, right?
Well, yeah, I mean, you could call me the Honorable.
The Honorable Mike Connolly,
State Rep. We have a phone call, probably for these two gentlemen guests. Who's on the phone? Is it Dan the Man?
Oh.
It is, isn't it? Who's on the phone?
It's like a delay.
It is. He does this. Dan the Man does it to us. Dan, say hello. He's not. He's punking us. Is this Dan?
Damn.
Or is this the other guy? We have some strange calls. Did you hang up on that, Herb? No, you still got him on the line. Let him go. I've had enough, whoever it is. 617-500-7100. Do you think it was Dan, Lauren?
I don't know. I feel like Dan's way of punking us might be slightly different.
That's he just, might just not call
I
us.
I feel like we got a butt dial.
Yeah?
It sounded like a background noise.
Dan's mad at me, I think.
Yeah?
I have a funny feeling.
Have you heard from him?
No.
Oh, my gosh. Me neither. Shocking.
So. Well, we're talking about our.
Really
our,
upset too.
Who?
I remember the last call was like.
I was nice to him the last one. It was like two before that.
Well, it was because somebody, but somebody had passed, and so it was all serious. And
oh, now you're siding with him.
I'm just saying.
Were you on that? Were you here for that one, or did you hear?
Not the one where you had supposedly picked on him, but then remember he called us.
But I thought I made it up to him. We'll take this call too. We'll see. I'll see. They're playing our show back. Who is this? Oh, this is awful. Is that our troll instead? I think it is. Can we write that phone number down? What area code is it? Tell me what area code that is.
770.
770?
What the hell's that?
Let's look that up. I'm going to look it up right now. I think we're going to take a quick break. Connolly, how long do you have? Do you have to go soon?
I got to run. I'm supposed to be at this thing.
I want to ask you like 9 million other questions.
Okay. Yeah. It's. I got to go soon.
You got to go? What are your big, like your platform going forward? What are the things you're hoping to get done at the State House now you're elected?
Yeah. I think transportation, affordable housing, public education, climate change, don't have climate change. Let's stop climate change. Economic justice, criminal justice reform, universal single payer health care, or at least a public option.
Mm-hmm.
And reforming the political system would be the top eight issues that we had in our race. And certainly, as we thought about legalizing, regulating, taxing marijuana, I think that's certainly a big goal that we had for both, things like criminal justice. Also I think, again, just coming back to the marijuana question, I actually hope we don't spend hardly any time on this because I think there's so many other things that we ought to talk about, like affordable housing and public transportation, both of which are, emergencies.
Even fixing the roads and bridges too as well.
Right, so.
And for the people who are taking cars. Do we take that call again? What's going on? Yeah, we took it? Oh. Is it the same number, Herb? No, new call. Okay. Who's on the phone?
It's Rhodes.
What's up, Rhodes?
Not much. Just saying congratulations and trying to be part of the celebration from out here in Sharon.
You're not being the angry black guy today? You're being the happy celebrating black guy?
Yay!
I've always been the happy celebrating black guy.
I know. I was going to say. Since Rhodes, when is Rhodes angry?
Yeah, Rhodes just has passion.
Oh, not, see?
He believes. He
just believes. We the people.
We the people.
We the people. Rhodes, you got a fan club.
Congratulations, Mike Connolly. Senator Mike Connolly. And thank you to the Yes on 4 campaign manager or representative there as well.
Thank you.
It's been very informative. I've been listening, and it's like glad you guys are like actually talking about the issue and like letting the people know that it is very safe and highly regulated industry that's coming out.
Do you have any questions for them?
No, just where's the celebration afterwards?
Right here, right now. You missed it. I invited you.
Hey, Rhodes, thank you for all your hard work on question Yes on 4, on passing it too.
Now, I'm definitely going to try to make it down there. I just have to, like, get the, I'll try to make it down there before 7.
Ooh. All right.
All right. See y'all later.
All right. Thank you, Rhodes.
No problem. Thank you.
Rhodes collected signatures, too, for question 4.
Nice. Yeah. Thank you.
We're the Young Jerks. We're here every Saturday at 6, right?
Yes.
Yeah. We got to let Mike go. Should we just keep him? Should we keep him hostage? I want to ask him about Occupy Boston.
It's a comedy. Yeah, we got to do the comedy show, you know? It's,
about Binge. You were supporting Binge today?
Yeah.
Why were you there for Binge, Boston Institute of Nonprofit Journalism? Why did you decide to come down today for that event?
You know, I mean, I've been supportive, you know, from the beginning. And I also think that, you know, as we think about what just happened in the presidential and congressional elections, you know, it's a failure of mainstream politics. It's a failure of mainstream economics, and it's a failure of mainstream media. And so I think supporting alternative media, supporting independent media is so incredibly important, you know. I was in line at Binge, and I was joking with someone. I said, gee, you know, maybe we can break up some of these media conglomerates and take on the failure of media. And the guy I was talking to said, no, let's just keep them the way they are, and then we'll just keep doing awesome independent media. And so I thought that was a really cool perspective. But no, I think we have to really promote alternative media.
Awesome. I want to thank you for coming in again. I know you got to go do this thing. This be the guest of honor, I guess, right?
Yeah, you know, I mean, it's a perfect week for a comedy show, right? What could, you know?
I know, I imagine they're going to go after Trump a little bit, do you think? Trump and Hillary?
I have no idea.
Did you see the Hillary mask on the way in here?
I didn't, no.
On the door, on the front door coming in, someone hung on a Hillary mask
and
smoking a cigarette.
Oh, my goodness.
That's pretty funny.
Laugh so you don't cry.
Yeah.
That's how we
you have
go.
To, right?
Yeah.
I know.
We're going to have like a meditation next week or something to get people over this whole thing.
Have like 5 minutes of deep
breathing. We're going to do it at the end of the show, but we decided we had too much. So next week, we're going to dedicate some time to it, to getting over the whole. Because a lot of people like have lost it about the Trump thing. I'm sure you know a lot of people like that, right, Connolly?
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, people are in tears. I mean, at the event, we had an event on election night at Slum Brew. And, I mean, there was 10 people crying, you know,
oh my gosh,
by 11 p.m. So, I mean, it's definitely scary. And the very next morning, you know, I received calls from, you know, people who had concerns about, people in the community, immigrants, you know, Muslims, people who are,
right.
You know, that's sort of the thing. I mean, on one mind, I would like to sort of analyze what happened, but I think almost what takes priority over that is understanding that real people are in real fear right now. And
what
could
really happen to them too, though? Some of that fear might be really justified.
Right. And
it
so
definitely is. There's been a statistical leak with an increase towards violence against Muslims over the last year. So, you know, people are linking it to Trump's rhetoric.
Yep.
You know, you can say, is it just a common thing that's happening, or are these two actually causing each other? I'd say that they're causing each other.
Absolutely. And so, yeah, I think, you know, my perspective at this stage is just to say that, you know, our priority has to be to oppose the racism, the misogyny, the xenophobia, the hatred, the ignorance, the bullying that characterized the Trump campaign. And, you know, beyond that, if we can make it past that, and that's a lot to make it past, we really have to go after the mainstream politics, the mainstream economics, the fact that the Democratic Party seems to, you know, have lost working people, working families, to an extent that, you know, isn't sustainable.
That's right. I agree. That's why you're our rep. So I want to thank you again, Mike Connolly, for coming in today.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, we'd love to have you. You know, anytime you can come in. I know you're very busy. You're always doing stuff. I hit you up every week, and you're like, I got this, I got that, I got that. You're always doing this, aren't you?
That's why you got elected.
That's right.
Yeah, I love Cambridge. I love Somerville. So.
Yay.
And we can tell. I mean, that's the once we had you on our side, too, I could tell, like, we're getting somewhere, because people like you, and you know everybody, and You know how to get it done around
it's
here.
It's hard
to
miss.
Yeah, that's true too. big Mike or No Money Mike?
No Money Mike.
They call you No Money Mike still, don't they?
They do. Yeah, it's pretty cool.
I like it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that was a while ago, but the legend lives.
The legend lives on.
Yeah, it's true. Man. I'm still got people that won't call me Mike Crawford. They're like Mike Can.
That's who you are.
It's good. Yeah. It's good to have multiple names, you know.
That's, you know, especially if they're good people saying the name in a good way, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So we're going to take a break. We're the Young Jerks here at 6 p.m. every Saturday at 6 p.m. We want to thank, we had some new pledges this week as well on our Patreon website. So we're going to hopefully thank some of them. I know one of them is Freddie Frederick Soriano.
Thank you, Freddie.
Yeah, thank you, Freddie. Yeah,
he's well, and we should tell them thank you guys, because due to the Patreon, our patrons, we are able tonight to actually have somebody here video doing like awesome videography work.
Yeah, professional video with Steve Underick, who directed the Who Is Vermin Supreme movie. If you haven't seen that, check that out. It's if you know Vermin Supreme, you haven't seen that movie yet, you got to look it up. The movie is awesome. It's all about vermin. So we got a professional crew here filming us as well, and a lot of that to do to the money that people are supporting us with. They want to expand our show, help us promote it more, and that money is going to a good cause. So you know, we almost didn't do this show this week. We're thinking about taking a hiatus, but people decided they wanted our show to continue and get bigger and start giving money to us. So we're here this week celebrating, so I want to congratulate and thank all of our audience and our supporters and our phone calls. And I want to thank the great guests today. I know Mike Connolly's got to run, so thank you, Mike, for being here.
Thanks for having me. Congratulations, and, everyone.
You too. Good to see you. Congratulations to you and congrats to us. And Jim, are you going to be able to stick around maybe?
Sure, if cool. You'd like me to.
Yeah. Oh, we would love you to stick around. We'll take your phone calls too. Call 617-500-7100. It's myself, Mike Crawford, with my co-host Bree, and the old co-host Lauren Pespisa is here as well.
Former ex-co-host.
Well, she's a sidekick now.
I still hang around.
So. She's our sidekick.
Yep.
She's taking Rhodes' spot. We're demoting Rhodes, and Lauren's our new sidekick. She looks way better, doesn't she?
Shut up.
So we're going to be right back.
W-E-M-F.
We're back
radio.
Live. We're back live, the Young Jerks, on WEMF Radio.
Hello.
The promo's about to get weirder by the hour here.
It's like WEMF radio. Like, maybe.
See, I could
do some promos if you guys need somebody to record promos. I
just might take that clip of you repeating it and cut it into a promo.
You know what we should do as a promo? You said it last week, as those crazy people that said, Mike Crawford.
That was going to happen.
Radio.
That was going to happen.
It ruined my life. They've sent 40 million people after me. 10,000 patients. 10,400 patients in Massachusetts. What was that?
I've had a fleet between 6 states to get away from those WEMF well, listeners.
I think it was 13 states, actually, that she said, and then she listed that.
We're going back to the video from last week. Some people probably know what we're talking about, others don't, but that was pretty funny. These people went crazy on us.
If you want to, it's called Rob and Kate and the Humanitarian Church. And I think it's actually still on our page, a link to the YouTube video. It's
When you do the church and weed together and it's not the Catholic Church, I don't know.
It's the vegan church. That's what it was.
It's their own church.
They're a vegan.
They're the humanitarian vegan church.
Craziness.
Humanitarian Corporation Church. we're being funny today. You know, I want you to get nasty today with me, Bray, because we've been having this little feud about my Facebook Live videos, and you've had some really catty comments about them.
Well, you know,
number one, we looked up you were giving me a hard time because you said they were too long. I was at like 20 minutes or something, and I said
I told you they were 30 minutes long, and you said no, they were only like 10 minutes. Like, did you go look?
And so what I did after that is I did two of them for like 50 minutes,
just to spite me.
And I talked about you for like 20 minutes.
Wow.
And now you have to watch them and catch up.
I don't have time for this, Mike. Your Facebook, you know,
some
I feel
people
like
do. We had a lot of people paying attention. We did a short video today and no one paid attention to it. You
I felt like
that?
I should pay attention that way. I like in case you're going to talk about something that when you want to talk about on Saturday.
And more people listen, it seems like. I don't know why.
So when you go on for like an hour, like how many people do you have listening? Like when you go on for 50 minutes?
There were like 10, 15 at a time at one point.
I think they'd watch it after the fact though, too, when you post it.
Yeah, they
don't
do.
Yeah,
it seems like, I mean, some of our videos too, like I'm laughing, like we put out the Scotty Hacker one with, he did a short viral one basically, mm-hmm. where I I cornered the mayor of Boston's chief of staff, Dan Coe, the young kid there.
Oh, I saw that video this week. That
and
was
that
great.
Video got like, I don't know. I'm just throwing out like 10 million views.
Oh, my goodness.
No, it didn't
there's
10,
no way it got 10 million views.
No, but
saying
it did
you went of, viral.
Let's look at it, though. I mean, there is a number on there, and the number is impressive.
So you're going to underestimate the it's amount of million. Minutes that you spend but talking on Facebook Live and then over-exaggerate your
views. Is what I'm
views.
Saying, though. At the same time, like when I'm looking at the numbers on the Facebook page, like the metrics on the videos are going through the roof, Brie.
People
and
like,
you're not doing them. You haven't been. You haven't been
you
pulling your weight around. I want
Facebook
you to do a
15-minute
video on Monday morning.
What do you want me to talk about?
I don't
Mike?
Know. What do you?
How do you think? Just pull some headlines and.
I don't know. Yeah.
Go on and chat about them.
That's what I do.
What kills me though, Mike, is if I watch the whole thing, sometimes if you're just talking about one thing, like I think it was one of the, when you were going after like the reporter, Shirley
Long.
That,
there you go.
You would repeat
some good
it.
Stuff.
I was like, is he going to tell me more that you'd like loop it for your new viewers
new
that
are coming
in. On.
You're right.
So
exactly.
It was like watching the morning news. I have the morning news on is, looping. I have you on looping your
yeah.
story.
Because this
I
is the thing when you're on
it.
Facebook Live, right? You start telling you stuff and you look up and there's like one person listening. And then like 10 minutes later, there's like 15 people listening. So you're like, I got to tell the whole story again.
They're not going to know.
It's so funny. Oh it's weird, isn't it?
Yeah. No, I enjoy that. If the viewers enjoy your Facebook Live, by all means, don't stop. Just
well,
because...
let us know. Should I stop doing them? We have a professional film crew. Maybe we should get more professional all the time. I don't know. What do you think?
I think for your Facebook Lives, though, my only thing is you got to hold the camera up like a little bit higher on your face because the angle of your face
you're really
is
getting
a little
catty
awkward.
Now. You really have. This is Facebook Live. It's free. You're lucky again, all right?
You got to take what you can get with
well, I mean,
Mike Crawford.
We have Jim in here. We want to talk to Jim more, but a couple of very exciting things happened on Facebook Live this week when I was. Did you hear about some of those? Number one, I was in a parked car, in my parked car.
Oh, I did see
and
that
I got
one.
Hit. I got hit by an old lady. And then I got out of the car, and she almost ran me over, and she didn't even apologize. She got out of her car and, like, glared at me. Like my parked car did something to her car.
A hit and run captured
she didn't
on
say,
Facebook Live.
Oh, I'm sorry I hit your car. No damage. I wasn't worried about it. And then this was why I was live. I got out of the car. I kept it going. It was hilarious. And then... Oh, Carmelita decided to pop into a couple of my videos, and she wasn't too damn happy about it. So, Yeah. I need like a safe room, I think, to do these Facebook Live videos now.
You just need like a do not disturb sign to hang on the door, like Do not disturb Facebook Live.
But once my girlfriend sees that Carmelita, she'll throw a shoe at me. Like she'll try to like she's like
I like her.
Yeah, she doesn't
she
like the Facebook
great.
Live either.
Oh goodness.
Yeah.
Yeah, no. I think if people like them, and especially some of the things
you're
saying are really
important.
She's
important. Really popular. Like, if she did one on her, I think if I did it on my own Facebook page, I get more views, actually.
I think you would, too.
And her, geez, Christ. Like, have you seen Charles Lacordaire? One of her friends, Charles mm-hmm. Lacordaire, you know who he is?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He does it. He gets so many people. You can't even keep up with the comments. It's just funny.
Well, as it keeps getting shared and shared, too.
Yeah, and he's funny. He's like, I don't know why people are watching me. I'm an old fart. Look at me. And I'm sitting there watching him going, I don't know either, Charles.
But here I am watching.
I guess we miss him. We miss watching and listening to Charles Lacanera in Boston. He's out in Hawaii. I'm a Facebook friend of his as well. I know him mostly through my girlfriend who used to do his show way back. So that's Carmelita. People might know Jim. I'm going to say his name. You say it.
Jim Borgazzani.
Thank you.
Perfect.
Yes.
Was that better than my first time? Or was it?
It was better than yours. Yes.
Yeah. So my first one really wasn't that good. It was. Yeah. It was just. Yeah.
I'm used to it. Believe me.
He was being kind.
So we're talking about legalization going forward here. People have a lot of questions. They want to know how quickly they can expect to get marijuana from a store.
Yeah.
When is that going to happen? Tell us quickly.
Probably not till early 2018. I mean, possibly late 2017. But, you know, you have to get the regulations up and running to, you know, govern the industry. We have to get the application process up and running. So the regulators have to be given time to write a lot of regulations. And by the way, we give them deadlines. you know, because we don't want to see what happened with medical. We don't want to see some sort of delayed rollout. So retail sales won't begin until early 2018.
Deb Goldberg, the treasurer, is going to be in charge of this?
Yes.
She's already asking for a delay on the implementation.
Yes.
Do you think that's valid, or do you think that it's a stalling tactic? Well, how do you feel about that?
We have no complaints about Deborah Goldberg. She personally opposed this, but she was measured in her opposition. She didn't come out. Her rhetoric wasn't inflamed. It wasn't alarmist. She did say that she thinks she needs more time to roll it out. We oppose that, you know, respectfully. We point out that the other states, Colorado, they had the same time frame in which to write their regulations. They did it. You know, the other states had the same time frame. Are they trying to imply that Massachusetts somehow is less competent than
right.
the other states? You
That's
know?
Weird.
I think that we have the same ability to, if not better, to roll out these regulations on time. So we're going to oppose any extension, because once you start doing that, it's a slippery slope, and suddenly it becomes, what else can we do to delay the will of the voters? And we're going to oppose it.
What about the other part where... she brought up that it's unfunded until the stores get open and start selling. Like, there's not going to be any revenue to her department or to set this up, this commission.
Yes. I mean, she's right. There's not. Obviously, you can't get funds until you start sales. The same thing happened with the gaming commission. Now, they put up the gaming commission, and there were no revenues coming in until they started the licensing process. They did a bridge loan type of thing. The legislature gave them some money to get up and running. You know, they need staff. They need office space. They then will pay the legislature back for that. So already, this is a template for that. We're not recreating the wheel here. So, yes, she's going to have to ask for some money in the supplemental budget. It's not going to break the bank. We're talking about three salary commissioners. They have to hire some staff. You know, it'll be, if it's an appropriation that's any more than $2 million, I'd be surprised.
And substantial tax revenues for doing that.
Substantial tax revenues.
What are we talking about? How much money? Like
$100 million by the year 2020. I mean, that's by the year 2020.
That's conservative too, right? They could even be a lot more than that.
It could be a lot more, and it probably will be.
Yeah.
Yeah, but $100 million by then. And that is going to be one of the main opposition arguments was, you know, the revenue was not going to cover the expenses.
Which is crazy.
Which is crazy. All you have to do is look at every other state. Revenue has far exceeded projections and has easily covered expenses, easily.
Yeah, I mean, in Colorado, they had to figure out what to do with the extra money that was allocated, because they had, you know, they have these laws in Colorado that if they expect to raise $100 million and they end up raising $150 million, they have to figure out what to do with that additional $50 million, because that's not really what the intent of the law was
Correct.
At first. And they basically ended up keeping it and using it for the schools and their...
Yes.
Fire departments and
yeah.
and it's all good. Like
they're using it for job training right. programs. They're using it for 4-H clubs. A lot of this goes to local communities too. Remember, in our tax, you know, we do 12%. There's 2% the community option tax
can add it on
right to the communities. You know, so you know, we think that's not only an incentive to not delay, you know, implementation or opening of stores, but it'll help these communities who are seeing their cherry sheets or their local aid get cut, you know? So we think it's a good thing. And finally, you know, instead of being subsidized by taxpayers, marijuana is going to generate revenue for taxpayers, you know? And
do they get that kind of money from alcohol? Like when they sell a 6-pack of beer, they don't get $2 or whatever, right? Or
no.
2%?
Alcohol's tax, there's an excise tax on alcohol paid by the wholesalers. Or I think it's by production. So there's not a retail tax. There was... It got overturned.
But the city or town, do they get extra money?
No, they don't.
But they'll get it from marijuana, which is good.
They will get it from marijuana.
The city or town.
So that means it'll be better for a city and town's budget to have dispensaries and to have medical marijuana systems in their town versus a liquor store.
Correct.
And a bar. That's
a liquor store returns nothing.
A liquor store returns nothing.
Maybe property taxes.
Right.
But there's nothing on the retail tax that goes to. No, they get a little bit of money on the license.
Right. Yeah, liquor licenses are pricey in Boston.
Yeah.
But I mean, marijuana licenses probably are too.
They will be.
Yes. So.
Yeah. Not as expensive as medical.
Right,
we made
right.
sure that it wasn't as expensive
well,
as medical,
and not as expensive as some of the liquor licenses that trade on the market.
You can sell
Boston.
Your liquor license. That's correct.
In Boston, I mean, the liquor licenses can go for like $500,000.
I mean, how many people actually sell the liquor licenses every year? Because I'm pretty sure it gets passed down to families.
They want to keep them, yeah. Because
yeah, people want to keep that. Yeah,
very valuable.
Very valuable. Yeah, very valuable.
I think the hard thing, though, is we're still going to be facing the stigma going forward. You know, the when you look at the breakdown of the voting city by city and the cities that were a little bit closer to 50-50,
yes,
it seems like there were there's definitely like strong opposition, especially in places like Dedham, you know, relatively large places.
Yep.
And so I'm wondering how that's going to affect not only recreational going in, but medical places who want to go into these cities. And now the cities are, if they're afraid of legal pot being available,
right,
if they're going to have kickback for the medical system going in now.
Well, we have seen already some medical establishments make an agreement with the city to not go to adult use.
Correct, like Patriot Care in Boston.
Like Patriot Care in Boston. So that, there's nothing in our provision that stops anybody from doing that, you know? Mm-hmm. And we're very careful. We had people, patient advocates, on the drafting committee because we're very concerned about how adult use marijuana will affect the medical market. And we don't think it will. We think there'll always be a need for medical marijuana dispensaries. First of all, they're not taxed.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have a medical marijuana card, you have an incentive to go to a medical marijuana dispensary because you're not going to pay tax.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think there'll be products in the medical dispensaries that you're not going to see in the adult use dispensaries. Maybe low THC products, you know, high CBD products. So, you know, our hope is that, and we haven't seen in other states that the retail industry, the adult use retail industry, we haven't seen a big impact on medical. They're coexisting, they're both doing well, and that's what we hope happens in Massachusetts.
Well, going forward, will, like, the campaign, you know, obviously has campaigned hard to pass this. The implementation part of it takes longer. It's like you said, 2 years. How much resources will the campaign have here and even MPP to really push it through to make sure that it does get implemented?
We're having those discussions now, sort of like how the campaign's going to transition into a post-election.
Right, like Trump's doing?
Exactly, it's like, yeah.
Like, where do you go?
Where do you go? So we're having those discussions now to see if there's, you know, some way, how we're going to look after, how we're going to help with, you know, we have no formal role in the implementation, you know, but because we were the ones who spearheaded, you know, the movement, hopefully that we're going to have some sort of say in, or at least some persuasion in how, you know, legislators go about this. So what role the campaign transforms into as we move toward implementation will be sort of decided over the next couple of weeks.
You know, one thing that's going to be really interesting, too, is part of the initiative, which I liked, was the social club aspect, where cities and towns can allow congregation, they can allow a high top times cop, or, you know, these social events, and there can be a smoking area if people want to, you know, enjoy themselves, just like they would at a, you know, a beer festival, or, you know, we have those all over the city of Boston all the time. Why can't we have something for cannabis? What I'm excited about is the vote, because there are a lot of cities and towns that overwhelmingly voted for, like Boston and Cambridge and Somerville.
And Somerville.
Provincetown.
Yep.
Where do you think that, I mean, obviously some of those places are probably the prime candidates. Do you kind of envision certain places that will go forward with that and, you know, other ones that won't? And
with a social club?
Yeah.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised to see. Obviously, you would look at where the vote was the strongest. You know, the pause, the yes vote. You know, it's hypothetical, but I wouldn't be surprised to see, you know, a town like Somerville say, hey, we think that we can responsibly set up a social use establishment, an on-site consumption establishment, more money for the city. So that wouldn't surprise me at all.
Keep Somerville weird, yo.
Yeah.
That's right, you know.
Tourism. And once, imagine the tourism that would come to Somerville.
Yeah. Somerville's great. I would love that.
Yeah.
That'd be perfect.
And I wouldn't be surprised to see perhaps Cambridge. Once one town or one city does it and people see that, hey, that it's responsible. All hell didn't break loose. And, you know, it's going to be a while. 100 years of prohibition and hysteria.
It takes a while.
And propaganda. It's difficult to shake off. You know, it just is. But when you see the electorate getting younger and younger, and people having the right approach to this that's not, you know, informed by the hysteria, then, you know, we're going to see, I think, a gradual acceptance of this. And again, it's going to be what were we all so worried about.
And this is not a dumb city. we're smart here, Boston, that's Cambridge, sure. Somerville. We're a smart electorate, and yes. You know, we'll be able to look at the data, look at the situation, and already, since we've already voted for it, I mean, clearly people have their heads in the right place.
Yeah. Yes.
So it shouldn't be like that bad, you know?
It shouldn't be that bad, yeah. And when you have people like Representative Connolly that has right approach to this, it's going to be a voice of reason.
Thank you. You know? Thank goodness.
You know, and I think that well, let's look at the leaders in some of these towns and hope that they have, again, a rational approach to this and don't play into the old stereotypes, the old...
I hope, you know, one place I think would be a good location for that, too, if you're any entrepreneurs out there, Salem, Massachusetts.
Oh, I bet.
They voted yes. You got witches, you got the goblins, you got the satanic temple up there.
They already burned plenty of sage.
A lot of the folks from Mass Patients Advocacy Alliance live up there now, too, so a lot of artist community. That's another great location. I guarantee that.
We also had a...
How about Halloween up there?
Oh, I was there for Halloween, and we were walking through with Yes Halloween on Cup. Four signs through the craziness of downtown Salem, and there were some Christians who were on their soapbox preaching to a group that was looking at them just in shock.
Oh,
they didn't know what to do.
What are they doing in
and
Salem?
And we went in front of them with the Yes on Four signs, and the whole crowd started chanting, Yes on Four! Yes on Four! To drown out the Christians.
Well, there were some storefronts in Cambridge that had the Yes on Four signs with some people who we all know who they were who were in Cambridge that did a good job getting the word out.
Who's on the phone here? Hello.
Hey, this is Mike. This is Sean Birdie. How you doing?
Good. How you doing, Sean?
Good, man. I was in my car and the feed went dead, so I figured I could call and listen.
Perfect. I'm glad you're calling. We're with Jim from the Yes on Four campaign.
Oh, hey, Jim. How you doing?
Good. How are you?
Good. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
And do you have comments on the show, or you got a question for Jim?
Yeah. So there's a lot of talk in private groups and on social media about the implementation of the December 15th deadline and talk about that trying to get extended as far as home cultivation and pretty much as far as home cultivation goes. Any word on them trying to delay that?
Well, there's rumors that they might try. I don't think they're going to delay the personal possession part of the law. So on December 15th, it's going to become legal to possess marijuana. I have no doubt of that. They haven't even talked about extending that, and I don't think they will. There is some talk about either delaying or limiting the home grow. We'll see what happens with that. I don't think they're going to take action, frankly, before December 15th. So
technically right now, I wouldn't be legal to grow 6 to 12 plants, but on December 15th, I would be?
That's correct.
Stop planting seeds December 15th.
Exactly.
A lot of people are going to be planting seeds.
Till your soil, start your gardens.
Yeah, get your seeds. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, that all starts, you know, we go through this sort of odd gray period where it's legal to possess marijuana, but it's illegal to sell it. You know, you're selling it without a license. Other states went through it. Again, and they seem to do fine, you know. So we're not doing anything that the four states that have gone before us are doing. And by the way, California is going to go through it. So is Nevada. So is Maine. You know, we saw this wasn't just Massachusetts. This was
nationwide.
Arizona. It only lost in one place.
It won everywhere. Medical.
And by the
way,
next year, 2017, Canada, the entire nation, is going to go legal. Right. They're not doing it with a patchwork approach. They're not going province by province.
Yep.
The entire nation is going to go to a taxed and regulated system. So we're seeing...
Cannabis nation.
Mm-hmm. We're seeing a major transformation with our social approach to marijuana.
And people realize, I mean, the majority now in America agree it's time to legalize.
That's right.
It's happening. I'm doing a... Someone is interviewing me from the Boston Globe magazine next week. And it's about athletes and cannabis. That's another, like, you know, so many athletes in the past, you'd be penalized. You'd still be penalized in sports for using cannabis so often. But maybe it shouldn't be. Maybe that would help out in some of these NFL injuries, the brain trauma. It definitely helps athletes. I want to see more talk on that as well.
Right.
I think
it helps them therapeutically, but it's not a performance enhancing.
Well, it can be. You know, this is where we might argue. But you
think
know,
it can be?
Because when you know, I talked to Toby Greer. He's an MMA fighter.
MMA.
Thank you, and mixed martial arts. And I'm a wrestler as well. I used to wrestle, and there are a lot of jiu-jitsu guys, you know, judo. There, it's all kind of the same stuff, you know, different moves, different rules. But a lot of it's grappling, and a lot of the grapplers, like that I know, a lot of them smoke pot, and a lot of times they smoke pot and work out, and they find that not only did they have better workouts, their lungs would expand, so they could go longer.
Interesting.
It allowed them to recover quicker. So it could be performance enhancing, but you know, so aren't, isn't protein, isn't milk, isn't right. like, you know, using Bengay for your, you know, is it a bad performance enhancer? That's right. my question. No, I don't think it is. I don't think it should be banned for, right. you know, if it is, you know, and I think that like Eddie Bravo and a lot of these fighters you see from the MMA, a yes. lot of them use cannabis and they're making a stink about it too. And I love that whole thing where. So many of my friends growing up were totally against it, but now they have the injuries from sports. And so many of my athlete friends are hitting me up now. Like guys that I would never expect. They're like, where do I get seeds? They're coming out of the woodwork. Kids I grew up with that, like, you know, they were they're coaches and teachers now, and they're looking for it, man.
Respectable members of society.
Yeah. They're not like me. They're not. These people are like serious people, and they're all hitting me up now. They're all former athletes, and it's like the thing now for athletes, because they look at it and they're like, you know, the alternative is surgery, right. which can work and so often doesn't, or pills.
Right.
And we know what the pills do.
Yeah.
And pills are fine short-term use, I think, but if you need them for pain for dozens of years, like a lot of us do, no, you can't do that.
Right.
So cannabis is it.
Well, we had a guy, you may know him, we had Stephen Mandilli, who's a veteran.
Right,
a veteran, just a great guy, and he put his whole heart and soul into this. I mean, his life was transformed. He's the one that went in front of the State House, did a one-man protest, demanded to speak with
Charlie Baker. Well, Charlie, Charlie offered him the meeting and then reneged.
And he put a cop in his place when they blew him off.
Yeah.
So
Steven's a good friend of ours.
He's a good guy.
Yeah, he is.
He's totally committed. And he has the story that you were just talking about. You know, this cocktail of pills that he got for free from the VA that was just making him, as he put it, a zombie.
Want to kill himself. That's where he was at.
Yeah.
He
discovered medical cannabis and his life changed. You know, and he couldn't get it through the VA. He couldn't even get it prescribed. And he says, meanwhile, they're giving me for free drugs,
dozens
that
of pills.
Killing me.
Yeah, he shows the list. I saw a draft of a story that he
incredible.
Wrote, and the list is just, you can't believe he's got categories of them. Like, there's five different prescriptions of muscle relaxers, five different prescriptions of anti-inflammatory. It just went on and 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 on. How many pills he was on?
Yes.
And for good reason. I mean, this guy really got hurt in Iraq. I have back pain. It's brutal. His thing is way worse, man. He got in a really serious car accident, Humvee accident in Iraq, and trying to avoid a, you know, improvised explosion type situation, driving right through, and he got really hurt, really bad. I mean, he's got pumps in his back, he's done every single therapy you can think of, on the verge of trying to kill himself, and he's got kids, and he's got a beautiful wife, and the dude's the best guy ever. And
I know, he's been there.
Cannabis saved him, and you can see it. And he's a warrior, like
he's
you said.
He's a soldier on a front line.
We all love him. We give him a round of applause, cue. Stephen Mandilli today.
I think what's so important too with what he does is not only talking about cannabis, but also about alternative healing, the whole
package.
How it's all so important. And I really hope that cannabis in this discussion and what Stephen's doing can lead to other forms of healthcare reform with acknowledging these things, and also allowing more advanced treatments, having them become more affordable or maybe more as first
prices.
Options to people rather than putting them towards pills.
And the other things we talked about, alternative care, again, dogs. The service dogs for veterans, that's a huge thing for people with PTSD. And just walking, like, you know, I've started walking dogs. You wouldn't believe the health difference it makes.
You
when
look
you're
really
walking
good today.
Every single day.
I think you're starting to get the glow.
Yeah,
the dog glow.
You have a glow.
I shaved too.
The canine glow. Oh yeah, that too.
I had one beer today. Maybe that's it.
Yeah.
Maybe I'm just buzzed.
He's just
Wow, I'm getting a lot of compliments.
I know. I think it's
this is usually, but usually I got beat up. I don't know. What did I do today?
He's got the glow. I don't know.
Everybody's happy. Weed is legal in Massachusetts.
I know.
We won.
And Mike Connolly won.
Yep. Right? Like our friends won. Yeah. We won.
Because I thought Mike Connolly had a chance, but I thought he would come up short. I thought it would be like 200 votes short.
I know he'd win when he beats him to me.
Well, no, that's what I'm saying.
Oh, you mean before? Yeah, I know. I know. He's our friend. Who, like, our friend's winning? That's, yeah. You know, like, sweet.
And especially Tim Toomey. I mean, it's hard to be an incumbent here.
Yeah.
But legalization, too, though, at the end, I was very confident in my predictions. But honestly, deep down, I was afraid we were going to lose.
Me, too.
Did you ever feel like that, Jim, that this might not make it? And how, I mean, it was still pretty tight. We won by a good margin, but
we won by a good margin. There was one poll. I mean, we had internal polling that never showed us behind. Our internal polling had us about 7 to 10 points ahead. And so our internal polling was right on the money. We saw a poll come out the Friday before election day that had us 27 points up. That was the Western New England University poll.
That's the one that got me really excited.
Yeah. And then we thought, wait a minute.
Hey, Mike, can I ask a follow-up question?
Oh, yeah. You're still there. Hey, go ahead, Sean.
Yeah.
Oh, thanks. Ooh, thanks, Herbie. Herbie's killing us. Herbie, we didn't know he was still there. Go ahead, Sean.
with that margin of victory, I think it was 250,000 votes. What previous ballot initiatives with that kind of margin have lawmakers been either afraid or emboldened to go in afterwards and change things? I mean, is that a good enough margin of victory is what
to
I'm
make
getting
a difference.
At to not change anything?
Yeah, historically, they pretty much don't. If they do change it, they don't change it by much. They did change Proposition 2.5, but really, it was changes that would allow the implementation. They didn't change the intent. Yeah. So we're hoping.
The only time I've ever seen them really touch an initiative was that gas tax.
Correct.
Like they totally wiped out this gas. It was a discount. They were going to reduce the tax, and the government didn't like it. That's the only time I've ever seen them really change an initiative.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And so they've done it maybe one time.
Yeah. They generally don't.
And they get
a
lot of crap about it ever since.
I thought that the laws were much tighter with ballot initiatives.
Legislature and the state house through the governor can change a law anytime they want.
They can change anything they want.
Yep.
Yeah.
I wish.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Sean. Thanks for calling.
Thank you, Sean.
Have a great day.
Thanks for supporting us, too.
Don't mention it.
Yeah.
Sean's a good dude. Thank you.
Thanks.
I mean, back to the polls, you know, when they got the late money, they got $1 million
from
Sheldon Adelson, $850,000 from the Archdiocese.
And then the money from the casino, the other casino guy.
Stephen Wynn gave $100,000. But we knew that late money, they were going to buy more TV time. But at that point, every dollar was
more money.
But you didn't get a lot for your money because TV time was so tight because of the New Hampshire Senate race.
Kelly Ayotte. Yep.
Kelly Ayotte and Maggie Hassan.
Oh, God.
So, I know.
So glad it's over.
Thank God.
Actually, that worked out for us.
I never want to hear those names again.
Because when you make a late buy like that, your money doesn't go as far.
Yeah.
We reserved our TV time back in
months,
the summer.
Yep.
So we knew we got a lot more for our money than our opposition did. And when they came out with that first ad, that ad, we thought, backfired on them.
Yeah, it did a bit. It went viral against them, too.
It went viral against
nationally,
them. They got terrible media.
Which ad was
the Kevin
one?
Ad.
Kevin.
Oh, the one with the sun coming out.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
God. Me and my dad and my family made fun of that ad every time it came on.
Everybody did. Nationally, it got made fun of.
Nationally. Yvonne Abraham at the Globe wrote a great column about it.
It was awesome. I mean,
Diane Williamson at the Worcester Telegram Gazette wrote a great column about it. It was ridiculed.
It was ridiculous.
It was ridiculous. Yeah. So you know, in a campaign, no matter how much what the polls are saying, when you look and you see when they came out with the state trooper's widow,
Clarity.
With that ad, you know, that was effective.
Right.
You know, and you know her loss. She suffered a terrible loss. So you know the sympathy factor, but again, they got it late. And maybe they didn't buy enough spots to have an impact. Maybe it wouldn't have made an impact anyway. I think the people who did our TV, our creative was very good. You know, the fact that we had a Washington State sheriff basically telling people, look what's happening in our state. I think people needed to hear that. So, you know, well, like any campaign, you have a lot of things that go your way, some that don't. And basically, if you pivot off the ones that don't and you just stay with your message, then you can come out okay.
Yeah, we won. I mean, that's the most important thing about it is that
it
won.
The most important thing.
Yeah. And 54% to, 46? Is that what the final tally was?
Yeah.
I mean, that's a good margin still.
That's a solid win.
That's a solid win.
We're very happy.
So I was close then. I had guessed 54% last week.
Did you win the prize?
I never said, like, my low, what I thought the no.
You know what? You always have to bend the rules. Because we had a contest online, too, and to see who would predict it. And
did anybody else?
I thought you might have picked it. And now I'm like, man, she picked it, but she didn't really pick it. Now you screwed it all up. You screwed up a whole contest by winning it, number one. And not letting me win, the big ego.
With your 59%.
I was 59, 39. Yeah, I was off.
You were ambitious.
Hey, somebody had to be.
Yeah.
I felt like, you know, the thing that really why I got cocky too is because the turnout, like the early turnout for early voting was really high. And they were saying it's going to be record. And it pretty much was a record turnout. So you expect we're going to win huge. But a lot of that turnout was these angry Trump people.
Angry Trump.
Yeah. I really, right. You know, yeah. Even in mass. Angry. Yeah. So. It didn't turn out quite well, quite expected, but it was still.
Well, that was another factor. A third of the electorate voted early, so they've cast their votes before a lot of our opposition ads started to run.
Which is good.
Which is good. Mm-hmm. You know, so they weren't. You know, the ability to penetrate the electorate when a third of them has already voted, that helped also.
It's pretty funny that because they look at it, you know, a bunch of stoners outwitted these right. Inside politicians.
Stoners have been waiting to vote on this for how many years, though?
We are organized, the institutional powers of the state.
Some people, you know, that's the one issue.
It was funny.
I know you might not be a stoner, though, John. I don't know. I'm not calling everyone in the campaign a stoner, but I am.
Yeah, right.
It was a funny thing. I think a lot of the media thought, you know, this is just another attempt by some sort of like crazy people. And suddenly we turned in 120,000 signatures, and it changed like that.
Right.
The Boston Globe, a lot of other medias, and the people up on the Hill suddenly took us very, very seriously and took the movement very seriously. And we saw things change right after that very, very quickly.
Never underestimate what a small group of people can do to change the world.
Right.
Because, indeed, that's the only thing that has.
Yep.
Even when, you know, Charlie Baker and Marty Walsh are so adamantly
Jason
against
Lewis.
I wonder how they feel with their tails between their legs
they,
now.
Not only did they oppose, they took the unprecedented step of formally creating a committee.
Right.
I've been around politics a long time.
Yeah.
A long time.
I mean, let's talk about some of the crazy stuff they did.
Well, first
like,
of
they
all,
basically took bribes through this campaign. I'm calling them. You might not say, Jim, but in my reporting, And I'm not saying that they're aware that they're bribes, but the people who gave the donations probably thought that it was almost a bribe because you got a major developer in Boston who's putting through a proposal that's controversial, that's too high on the waterfront, that might be breaking environmental laws of the state of Massachusetts. And Marty Walsh and them just pass it right through. But, he gave a huge contribution to that campaign.
He sure did.
And then the governor writes the forward or whatever you call it to the ballot question, the piece they mail out that's supposed to be objective and nonpartisan and non-campaigning, and he basically lies throughout the whole thing.
It was terrible.
I mean, these guys did a lot of shady stuff to
the statement of fiscal consequences. If any of your listeners have their voter guide at home, you look at the
voter guide. That's the word.
You look at the statement of fiscal consequences, and the way they describe our measure was totally different than the other three questions. It was biased. They used unsourced information. So, and we complained about that.
Yeah.
It didn't do any good. It was already printed.
And I mean, do you think that they'll have it face any consequences, Walsh or Baker or Jason Lewis in the future for this crap? Like in terms of getting reelected?
I wish. I hope.
I doubt it.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think it was. I think Charlie Baker and his team took a hit that day because they had two questions lost. You know, question two, which Charlie Baker went all out for.
Right. Yeah, he was in the ads.
He looked really bad in those ads, by the way.
Yeah, that got
It was
swamped.
Weird. He looked really bad.
They got wiped out.
That was a landslide.
Yeah,
that was a wipeout.
I know a lot of activists that were, you know, very pro-no-on, too, that were working. And a lot of, student activists, too, and people that, it really especially affected. So I was very happy to see that.
So once again, Massachusetts voters have shown, they did in 08 and 12, they don't take their cue from elected officials when it comes to ballot questions.
Or out-of-state funding.
Corporate money.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I mean, there was a lot of... They try to say that we had, on question four, all this corporate money. No, it was actually some money from people who wanted to change the law. And it wasn't corporate money. But corporate money actually was hugely fun in that question, too.
On the other side, four. Liquor industry.
Yeah, liquor industry and the opposition, right? And that was the real corporate money.
Gambling money.
Right.
and God.
Yeah.
The Catholic Church, you know?
Oh, God, that was very disappointing.
It was funny.
Because of all the things the Catholic Church can be should be fighting against, marijuana is not even number 10 on that list.
And not only
on
were
list.
They funding like, it, but if you went into Catholic churches, they actually had pamphlets.
Yeah, they
and
were they campaigning.
I know. It affected my grandparents' opinion until I set them straight.
They even sent it to the Catholic schools, from what I hear. They sent things home, and
And, you know, really, what's the Catholic Church? Jesus never said don't smoke weed.
Yeah.
You know, and Jesus said,
I think
don't
he said,
judge.
Sow the seed or something like that.
Yes, he said, sow the seed.
Something good about
spread,
the seed.
They may have been mustard seeds when he said, spread them
seed.
On your soil or whatever, but you know, they could have been marijuana seeds too.
And this misperception that the Catholic Church had that they had to protect the people that for some reason.
Who sold them that?
Meanwhile, what they're doing is ignoring the people who had been adversely
impacted
historically.
That's what I was saying. How do you ignore all that? How do you ignore all that? Because he was all he was talking about is this alleged harm from cannabis that he saw it down when he was in the islands or whatever. He's ridiculous. I think it was a made-up story myself. And then never mention the harm of prohibition, because the harm from prohibition is so much more than any harm you could ever find for cannabis.
Yes.
It's the harm of prohibition. I didn't lose a career because I smoked marijuana. I lost a career because I got busted with marijuana. One joint. I mean, and now, okay, one joint is legal. Great. But there are still kids getting there busted in Roxbury because they ended up with two dime bags. I mean, give me a break. This is what's been going on.
It's terribly hypocritical for them to ignore the social injustices of the communities, that the very communities they should be protecting.
Right, the poor and the minorities.
Exactly. Yeah, it was very hypocritical. I'm Catholic. I'm not a practicing Catholic anymore.
Me too.
So right, same here.
Yeah, same here. I looked at that and I thought, there's another example of why you're losing people like, apparently, all of us.
Right, because, you know, really the issue should be poverty and the stuff that, you know, the Christian church should be focused on. And, you know, the marijuana laws are affecting poor people more than ever, because when they don't arrest them for possession, they arrest them for possession with intent. They charge them with possession with intent right now instead of just possession, and then just so they can.
Right.
You know, and that's a much heavier charge. And I've seen a lot of people in court since I've been there with possession with intent charges for marijuana. And I'm, you know, had my fingers crossed that this law would be passed, and the next time they go to court, it will be like dismissed.
And those possession with intent charges, you look at the communities where they come out of.
Right. Dorchester.
Dorchester, Mattapan, Roxbury.
Mm-hmm. Even Cambridge.
Right. Now, if that was a group of white kids that got caught in Duxbury or Andover or Lincoln, you're probably not going to see anybody charged with possession with intent. So it's the application of the law.
Right. Instead of giving them misdemeanors, they're giving them felonies.
Correct.
That's right.
The ACLU came out with their great study.
They get that
in
map
the weeks,
too.
In the weeks coming up to the election, the ACLU came out with good data, got great press. It helped us with our narrative. It was difficult. It knocked the opposition off balance. You know, and with campaigns, the more you control the narrative, the more votes you get.
And that did help. I mean, you have a map that shows where the busts are happening. We're out of time this week, though. I want to thank you so much, Jim, for coming in.
Thank you.
For everything that you did, your campaign, you guys won yes on 4. Marijuana is legal, de facto legal in Mass right now, I'll say, because it happens really December 15th.
That's
but
right.
I don't think any police are going to bust me for a joint on the way home
today. Start investing in your grow equipment now before prices start skyrocketing after
some
December.
Get some seeds.
Your grow tent.
Yeah.
Let's go.
I want to give you just a round of applause for the big win. Congratulations,
Thank you.
Jim.
Thank you.
And for all of your work. Thank you.
Thank you, all of you, for all of your work. Thank you.
And I want to also thank Mike Connolly, Mass State Rep elect Mike Connolly.
Oh my God.
For coming in today and answering our questions, spending some time with us. Congratulations to him as well and everyone who supported both of those campaigns. I know there's a lot of you. We know some of you. Mm-hmm. I also want to thank some people too. We got some more pledges for our show this week. Frederick Soriano. Thank you.
Thanks, Freddie.
Oh, yay, Freddie.
Daniel LaSalle also pledged some money to our show. Sean Birdie, who called in earlier, he's a new pledge to us too. And on his pledge, I see a yes on 4 sign right there.
Nice.
So he's got that on his Facebook profile still, which I like. Tony Elliott, also another new pledge, and Lisa King. So people are giving money to our show
Thank
and helping
you
us.
So much.
Yeah. And that's why we got a professional video team here today recording from the movie Who is Vermin Supreme?
Which, if you don't know, you should.
You should look up that movie. That movie is a great movie.
You should look up Who is Vermin Supreme.
We got the director-producer here filming us today, so we're happy about that as well. I want to give a shout out to Chris Ferrone and the binge party today. That was fun.
Ooh, holiday binge too. Yeah. Journalistic boogaloo.
Yeah, that was fun.
It was a party.
In Somerville.
I got to reunite with our best friend, that big Trump mask.
Oh, yeah, right.
Our old friend, Make America Baked Again.
Throwing stuff in there.
Yep, throwing his own words back in his mouth. It was great.
And I also want to thank Herbie, as always, being behind the board. Yeah.
Woo. Thank you, Herbie.
He's talking to the next show. They're coming up on New Air's program, the New Air's.
I think they brought him pizza.
Oh, did they?
Yeah.
Give us some pizza. We just keep shining
up
the New Air's program.
I was like, pizza?
Yeah. Hey, pizza and prog rock.
Yeah, prog rock.
Not a bad mix.
That's right. Alan's coming up. And you also, I want to thank the guy who bought me Burger King today, Scotty Hacker. He was in one of our he was in our Facebook Live video today, too.
Yes, made an appearance.
Yeah. And, yeah, I guess that's it. Oh, Lauren Pespisa, thanks for coming
in. Yay, I'm here. You're welcome.
You're our sidekick.
I know. It was so good to be able to celebrate with you guys today.
Yes.
Yes. And thank you, Bree.
Thank you, Mike.
All right. We'll be back next week, the Young Jerks. Actually, you're gone next week, right?
Yes, I will be gone next week while I'm working. Workcation. I'm headed to California at 6 a.m. tomorrow morning for work for 5 days, and then I will be... going after that, a little traveling, and then back for... Are we going to be on the week after Thanksgiving?
I don't know. We'll figure that out.
Yeah.
Do you want to? What do you think?
I'll be here, yeah.
All right, we'll do it.
I mean, what else are people going to be doing? You need to escape your conservative family.
Yeah, that's right.
You're like me, so...
I'm always willing to do it, to get out of there.
Right.
All right. We'll be back next week then. I will, at least, and Bree will be in... Where are you going to be? California?
I will be in California. I'll be in, L.A. and San Francisco.
Wow. Oh, yay, San Francisco, boo L.A., but have fun.
Thank you.
We'll see you next week.
This is WEMF Radio.
WEMF Radio.
WEMF Radio.
WEMF Radio.
WEMF
Radio. WEMF
Radio. You're listening to WEMF Radio.com.
WEMF Radio.com.
Sweet.